Hello, everybody. We're big, we're bad, and we're back with the rather wonderful Mr. Dave Jerden. How are you, my friend?
Good to see you, Warren, as always.
Always amazing to see you. This is a big song. When this song came out, I don't know if I'd heard guitars and drums this big, especially coming out at a time when the 80s drum sounds were just these huge gated drums, and guitar sounds, I don't know how to describe them. They just, nothing sounded quite as big as this song.
Well, when I was playing in bands, this is what we wanted to sound like. I mean, this is, you know how I got into developing this sound, which was when I worked with Frank Zappa. We spent countless hours talking about this sound and how to get it.
I don't know where to start. Do we start on the drums? Do we start on the guitars?
Because in conversations, that it's all about the guitar and the drop D and Tony Iommi from Black Sabbath. I mean, that's where I started with the sound.
I remember asking you about this guitar sound in like 98. I think it was Christmas of 98.
Yeah.
And you were telling me it was several amps and you had like different amps for different parts of the EQ.
Record, the first one, yeah, there were several amps, but it wasn't quite the setup that I had for Dirt, which was several amps.
First of all, where did you track this?
It was London Bridge. What was great about London Bridge Studio, they had tiles in there like you find in a school, those little asphalt tiles. And we all know the sound when a chair moves on it and stuff. We grew up with it. How do you describe it? But those tiles on there and stuff, just it all added to the sound. You know, once we got things set up and we liked the way it worked, we just cranked to this stuff. You know, it wasn't like, you know, it took a long time to record this. But, you know, most bands I worked with are good, including the Rolling Stones. They just knock it out. When I first heard about Alice in Chains, I got a phone call from a friend of mine at the record company, and he said he sent this demo around to all these famous producers, rock producers, and they all passed on it. And he thought they had something. Well, I got the demo, and I saw why they didn't want to do it, because they were all over the place. But I heard what reason I'd want to do it, because he sounded like Black Sabbath, which was all-time favorite band, because of Tony Iommi.
You know, yeah, he's amazing.
So you start with Tony Iommi and drop D. And like Megadeth took it to band, Dave Mustaine sped it up really fast. Okay, and then now we're talking about Metallica. I just wanted to slow it back down to Tony Iommi.
It's funny because honestly, again, sitting in England, sitting in the UK, when I first heard what bands were being called grunge bands, is I remember saying to my friends and us all thinking, this will sound like they listen to Black Sabbath.
Yeah, you nailed it. I mean, this is all about Black Sabbath. I think Tony Iommi is important as Jimi Hendrix, Jimmy Page. You know, I mean, he was a true groundbreaker because he knew he was into the sound. You know what I'm saying? The drop D sound. And besides, Tony Iommi just looks so cool in black.
Oh yeah, we're both sitting here in black. Well, we weren't color coordinated. It's just what happened.
Yeah. So I don't think I own anything but black.
What is your memory of guitar amps then?
Well, we were using there was a Randall. Yeah. Alan from 11 was the first time I was introduced to the Randall amp, and then Jerry had one, and it sounded great. It just didn't sound, you know, big enough. So I used two amps with him. It was a Marshall. I think it was one of my Marshalls, and
it's like a JMP, like a Plexi.
It might have been the Plexi. I don't remember, but I think it was. I like using the Plexi for recording basic tracks because there's not too much overtone, too much crunch, you know. So anyway, it might have been a Plexi, but it's not about the amps as it is about Jerry Cantrell, who is a phenomenal artist. I can't say enough things about Jerry. Just, you know, and Jerry and I were been friends, not friends, whatever, you know, but over the years. But Jerry's a real deal. That guy is rock and roll. I mean, Jerry, if you're watching this, sorry, but I say this. I mean, you're strange, but right. You're strange in a good way.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, over the years, I've met, you know, a lot of people in rock and roll. I've worked with a lot of people in rock and roll. And like Keith Richards, for instance, Keith doesn't make that shit up. I mean, if he didn't play guitar, I don't know what he'd be doing. He'd be a pirate or something. I don't know. Like he is.
I was Johnny Depp, yeah.
But Jerry's a real deal, man.
So this guitar sounds two amps. What was the Randall? Was it a 212 combo?
I think it was 212 combo, yeah.
So you had that and a Marshall 412. Mm-hmm. Now you're a vintage 25, aren't you? Or you're vintage 30? Because you had this cab that I borrowed from you for years.
I had two. I had them for different reasons. I had the 25 for doing basic tracks, big yep. crunch. And then for lead, I had the 30s, you know.
But you had that one cab. This was great. It had a 25, a 30, and a blue bulldog in it.
Right. I'd do that, too. I'd make it only recording. You can do that. You can mix them together. I thought it sounded good just standing back. But I've always been a bulldog fan. And that's the Vox. They put in the Vox amps. And I've always been, you know, like, I love Vox sounds.
So, miking.
Yes.
Any particular... Now, oh, wait there. The first thing, one of the biggest things I remember learning from you was front and back miking.
Right.
So on that Randall, was it open back? Were you able to get a mic in the back as well?
Well, I only do that with open back. I'll do the back miking because, you know, I mean, I'm not trying to mic it through the particle board
yeah,
and
yeah.
imagine it's coming. No, if I have an open back, I use that to, what happens is when you put the back mic up and you throw it back one out of phase with the front one, you get more low end, you get a hump yep. in there. So yep. that's what I like. But
I learned that from you, and every album I did after that, like the Frey albums, Augustana, all of that stuff, James Blunt, whenever I was doing all the guitar sounds, I use a small combo. Mm-hmm. Front with a 57, back 57, in line,
right.
So they're seeing so the speaker moving
looking
the same
at each
way,
other, yeah.
looking at each other, and reverse the polarity, flip the yeah. phase out the back.
You can always get a good sound like that, and yep. you know, when I worked with the Stones, I did that, and they were so amazed how fast I could get a guitar sound, and I said, look at these amps I'm using, you know, and two mics, there's not much places I can put them, but they always were amazed I could get, and Steve Lillywhite, who was producing, is always amazed I could get this really good sound. And I said, it's simple as that. I said, I've been doing that since I've been playing in bands. And that I started playing in bands doing that in 1964. Okay, so that's a long time. And it's always worked. My dad taught me that.
You're about to tell us about Frank Zappa. Because I've had many conversations with you when you were talking about Zappa.
Well, first of all, Frank Zappa, I mean, I can't say enough good things about him. Not only as a person, but just as smart. The guy He was on a constant quest for whatever you have, not just music, but name it. And, you know, I had so many conversations with him, and the conversation that we talked the most about was these big guitar sounds, you know. And we came to the conclusion it would take multi-amp to do it, you know, with each one working its own frequency band. And how would you do that? So when I, how we did it, I used a amp for the bottom, one for the mid, one for the top, and then kept the sound separated with high-pass, low-pass filters. Now, if you do that and have them all running up the console at the same time, it's a waste of time because all you're going to get is mush. But if you can have control of the low, mid, and high, and with frequency band, see on the SSL, every channel has a high high-pass, low-pass filter. So you can put it, you can have it only in frequency. So the bottom one is going to go to up to about 150 to 200. The next range is going to be 300 is the best cycles for the guitar. That's the basic for all the notes is 300 cycles. So you're going to put that 300 all through the mid, all the way up to about 6K maybe a little bit lower, and then an amp for the top that operates just on, let's say, 6K on up for the air on there. Problem with Marshalls are that they have a lot of frizz on them when you get a huge sound that is as loud and overtakes the energy. You see, there's the energy levels going through a console and into a tape, and there's only so much it's going to fit physics-wise. So, you know, you have to, what you're doing is with these high-pass, low-pass filters and separate, is you're really narrowing down the range that they have to play in. And
now with this sound, with the Randall and the Marshall, what are you, what's fulfilling what? What's the Randall doing? What's the Marshall doing?
No, well, I was also using, on this one, I was also using a, I believe it was one of those Tom Scholz boxes.
Ah, okay, the Rockmans.
Rockman, and that was on this high frequency.
Ah, okay.
And by itself, it was hell to listen to. It was just it was like a razor blade. But, you know, you add that to all that other energy, you actually need some, using a tube amp, I don't think it could put out the energy to compete.
So the Tom Scholz Rockman on the top. Right. What was the Randall and what was the Marshall doing?
The Marshall on the bottom and the Randall in the middle.
Let's have a listen to that guitar sound.
Now, one thing about this guitar sound, this guitar that's being played was made by Jerry when he was in junior high school in shop.
Oh, it was?
We tried every guitar to get the right sound, and that guitar worked. It was like a Strat.
Mm-hmm.
But he installed the pickups and did all the stuff and built the neck and everything. And it was for doing rock, it was best guitar I've ever run across. But that amp worked for this, the guitar for this sound. That's what this sound was all about.
Now, you add the bass to this and it's insane. And the bass has ambience on it.
Right. There's a box that I was using back then. It was a preamp box. For bass.
Was it the, I think I know what it is. Was it the SGX, the night bass?
Yep, night bass.
Night bass.
You nailed it, dude. You're good.
No, because I remember, look, I was in your studio in the late 90s, like, taking notes.
I only bought that piece of equipment for Mike, and he's the only one that ever used it. And the thing, I don't know where it is, it just disappeared. But everything I did with Alice in Chains, they were the only ones I ever did it with.
The night bass, remember that?
Yeah.
That squeal on the bass.
I tell you the problem with Mike is he plays with his fingers, and usually it can be a soft sound, and I want it like a pick, but he played with his fingers to get that sound.
He did a great job, it's amazing.
That's the reason you use that night bass.
I just love how raw it sounds. I remember as it, you know, when I first heard it, I remember thinking this was like the tightest machine I'd ever heard. It was so evil coming out because it was like Sabbath. It was like, claw.
That's amazing. Claw, you claw. Just described it. I said the same thing to Jerry, what we're going for. We're going for a machine with that kills. You know, something that's
first time you ever heard it was just like, what is this?
Yeah.
And then Lane comes in with that,
there was a video game lab we used to play, and it had one of these things in there, and we always thought of that sound being this character in this thing. It was like this dragon thing that just slipped through. It was this nasty game that Jerry had, and we used to play that, and it's just like we always had this mental picture of this character killing things.
And you know what's so amazing about that? God, and we should just isolate this, is like, because when you're playing these kind of games, that's the music you think of. So it's like, it comes full circle.
Yes.
So that's fantastic to hear. Yeah, that's the imagery that inspires, and it's also the imagery that works.
See, I think it's it works and it's fun. You know, I've always been in this for one reason only. It's the best expression of what goes on in my head, this music, and this type of music. I don't know how to describe it, but Man in a Box is really close. I mean,
that's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, if it's going to be something like, Doctor, I can't describe it, but I can play it for you. I can play that. And if you get that, you get me. You know, and how do you put words to that philosophically? But that always was a sound that touched my soul ever since I could remember. And I love the Beatles. I love a lot of stuff. But, you know, they didn't have that evil.
Darkness.
It's just something evil. It's like this. It's like, to me, it's like a Tiger tank in the German army, you know.
People that listen to these bands, that's how they feel. That's why.
And they're my people. These guys, I don't care how old I am. They've always been my people. They'll always. Well, I live downtown in L.A., and there's a hard rock bar down the street. It's called the Five Star, and they have bands from all over the world come in, but all the bands are like this. And, you know, I stand on the sidewalk. I don't go into bars. I don't drink. So I stand outside the bar. I know the barners and stuff. And I'll get a group of people around, and we talk all night about this because these are my people. You know, they understand it. They get it, you know. And who knows why, but it touches your soul. It gives you power. I mean, to me, my father's a musician. He said, "How? What are you hearing that?" I said, "I hear orchestras from hell and heaven playing at the same time."
What a great quote. We can't go anywhere further at the moment until we listen to these drums, which are just immense. I love that slight pause as it plays with the riff. And yeah, it's just right. Beautiful.
You know, when I was working with them, started working with them, I wasn't going to be able to record Sean, the drummer, because he had broke his arm.
Oh.
So I was going to use Jack Irons, who was a later player for Pearl Jam. I was going to use the original Pearl Jam drummer, and he could not play this. He just didn't get it. And I always a big believer that session players will give you the time, but they just can't, you know. Sean lived inside this riff for a long time, you know, and it's like, if he had to describe right down in music, you know, notation, the pauses and he couldn't do it. He doesn't know. And you can't explain it to somebody. I tried to explain to this drummer for Pearl Jam. I can't remember his name. He's the first drummer. He just didn't get it. And he was looking at me like I was crazy. But Sean knew exactly what I was talking about. You know, it's like take a breath, you know? It's like, you give it a chance to breathe and breathe in a real organic way, you know?
And it still sounds like a machine, but yeah. It's a breathing machine.
Well, that's
what's the so idea. Amazing about
it. It's all about the machine. I mean, when I saw Terminator 2, I thought, I was getting close, you know, but yeah. Not quite there, but... then they took it to some stupid other place. But, you know, there's video games I've seen, and there's, bad movies, but great graphics that I've seen that totally get it. But, I mean, these guys get it. I get it. You get it. You can't tell me. But I just remember trying to describe to my father, who's a good musician, what's going on there. And he would use, I said, use some terms that you use to describe this. And he'd say, noise. Okay. I say, I agree. I said that, and then he started to kind of get it, and you know, like it sounds kind of like a big machine or a tractor or something, you know, and yeah, now you're starting to get it, you know, but you know, I think, you know, there's been a migration of sound all the way from the late 1800s all through George Gershwin, you know, who first smashed that whole kind of music back then was like John Philip Sousa, and then Gershwin put the blues note in there and started to work that. And you know, there's, and how do you describe that? People that just, you know, like Jerry, he lives it. I mean, if you had to personify somebody, a living person that is that sound, it's Jerry Cantrell. And I'm not gonna say anything that, you know. This guy's a heavy dude.
So that's the drum sound. Same miking you were talking about before.
Yeah, exactly the same.
So D112.
U112.
57 top and bomb.
Yeah.
On the snare.
Yeah, Sennheiser 421s, Toms. For overheads, I think it was the AKG 414s. You know, it's once you get it, it's not rocket science, you know, but...
How were you miking the rooms on this? Do you remember what mics?
Yeah, I was using 387s.
387s?
Yeah, and the way I do them is I do them in figure eight, which is strange. What I do is okay. I did a gigantic binaural mix. I put figure eight pointing at, you know, and the sides, yeah. The dead sides pointing, and in the middle was going like this.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So, I mean, I try all kinds of things, you know, but... But I believe I was messing around with that configuration.
So how much of that is the room and how much of that is
no, that's all the room is. No, that's me, my reverb.
That's your reverb. What was your preferred reverb? Lexicons?
Yeah, I like the Lexicon digital reverbs. And there's sounds at large halls, things like that I like right. in there. That, you know, it's, reverbs can be great or they can kill you. But if you know how to use a reverb, I learned how to reverbs from this engineer who worked with Hendrix. And he told me reverbs are a must. But if you can tell a big reverb there, then maybe too much. But
was that Eddie? Eddie Kramer?
Yeah,
yeah.
He was a connoisseur of that stuff. You know, Eddie Kramer was all about plowing new ground. You know,
definitely
great engineer.
Yeah, it's absolutely fantastic. I remember the first time I heard this; it was blood curdlingly good, absolutely incredible. So I'm going to listen to the thing. Outside of the guitars and the drums, that really gives it that sound for me, which is this.
Yeah. It's Lane.
So what has he got on Lane's voice then?
Yeah, I just might have been my, which I used a lot on this record, was a small stone.
Small stone pedal?
Yeah, it's all over this record.
So how did you get, you went in and out of the SSL when you mixed using it?
Yeah. Yeah,
that's great.
I always have a pedal, a guitar pedal hooked up when I mix.
Nice.
That all those delays are, I had these Lexicon boxes, these separate boxes. So instead of using like the delay inside, you can get with inside the box, Pro Tools, it's all really good sounding now. But I still prefer a box.
Right.
I like, you know, the tactile feel of the equipment.
Sure.
The conversations that go along in between the takes. I love all that stuff.
So is this a PCM 42? Lexicon PCM 42, you think?
Yeah, it could be.
Yeah. Buried in my pit. I love it. It kind of sounds Beatly to me.
Yeah.
At the end of John Lennon stuff, you hear those same kind of delays.
Yeah, I love that song. Those intervals that he picks out for harmony are amazing.
Yeah, they're amazing.
It's very baroque. And
is that all Lane? Or was Jerry working with him on it? Or
no, it's just Lane. Everything you hear on there is Lane working out all those parts himself and coming up and singing them, just nailing it every time he got the mic. I mean, these guys aren't punks, man.
Yeah,
they're the real deal, and they were very serious about their music, you know. And I know about their backgrounds and things like this. And this was their shot, and they did not mess it up, you know. They knew what they were going. It took somebody like me. They had so many styles when it came along. They just need somebody to say, take the dart, throw it at the board, and say, stick with that, you know. And just completely convince them that's the way to go. And you know. It was because they had a producer that played this kind of music, you know, and understood what they're talking about. You know, I couldn't go into, let's say, I don't know, Frank Sinatra, whoever, and like, you know, explain to them on their level what it's all about. I don't know. But I know this. Right. I live this. I grew up with this. This is me. And this is what I wanted. And I had many conversations about how to get it. And Jerry and Lane and Sean and Mike gave it to me. They understood what I was talking about once I put it on a railroad track and it had a direction to go. So they were an incredible band. There are bands that you work with that really inspire you to go, to keep going. And Alice in Chains definitely is one of those bands.
Amazing. Yeah, I love Lane's vocals on this.
Bad. How great is that?
So that's the high note and you've got a delay on it repeating?
Yeah.
Let's listen to that again.
Hear the first one? The first one, the high note comes up and stops and starts twirling on top of the other thing. Yep. That's what makes that sound.
Yeah, it's amazing. And listen to it again.
You hear it go. Sounds like feedback. That guitar is doing that noise, that bang. We recorded these vocals at Capitol Records. We tracked it up at Seattle, London Bridge. Then we came down to Los Angeles. My wife was actually studio manager of Capitol Records at the time. I got her the job, told her what to say. So it was in this new Studio A, and she was manager at Capitol. And she said, you can come in, of course, and try the vocals out. If you don't like it, you don't have to pay for the date. So I set up every mic that they had at Capitol, and they have quite a collection of mics.
Oh, yes.
And I had him sing this song, just that part, on 20 mics, different mics. And there was one mic in particular that even the studio staff that heard what we were doing, they all came in. It was that M49. They couldn't believe they had that mic. They could do that in their, you know, it was just his voice with that thing. It was just huge sounding.
So it was an M49.
M49. And those things are expensive mics if you can find one. But they just, I mean, killed. Now, they have a new one. It's a new M49, 149.
149, yeah.
And I have that mic too, but it's just not quite as bright as this mic. But it still has, what I like about the 49 is it has body to it. Mm-hmm. You know, you can sing up like that and it still holds it. And I mean, when he sang through that M49 in the, you know, through the big speakers and all that, everybody's hair stood up on their heads. They went, whoa.
Oh yeah, I mean, it's insane how beautiful this is.
I'm the dog who gets beat. Save me. Jesus Christ, deny your maker.
Hey, you
Christ, will be wasted. Feed my eyes. Now you've sown this.
I was just listening to that. It's like hair-raisingly good.
Yeah, like Lane had this thing. You go out and start to sing, and it may, you know, his voice just wasn't there. And to me, it sounded fine, but to him, it's not there yet. And when he hit that mark, he could sing the whole album straight through. You know, it was just like getting up to that. You know, there was a mindset that he had that he got, and he was so humble about it. I mean, it's like amazing those intervals and all that, and the tone of his voice. I've always been in. Now you have to remember when I recorded this, there was like Guns N' Roses, all those high voices thing, you know, Dio type voices, and I never liked that, you know. I always, to me, my thing comes off the blues. That's my tip that I come off of making the blues like more powerful and all that, you know. And when I heard Lane's voice, I just went. Yeah, I mean, after that, then you had Pearl Jam. You know, when we first put this song out, this is the first song we put out, radio stations all turned it down. They all said Lane's voice is wrong. And there was a woman that there was this metal station here in Los Angeles, and this woman that was on she was, what do they call it, program director or whatever, that picks out songs. She was on the radio saying how proud she was of this band that she found and all this stuff and what's going on the radio. I was driving to the Concrete Foundation, which is a metal thing where all the producers, radio stations get there. I went straight to her and I said, you're full of shit. I said, I produced A Man in a Box, and she turned around and walked away. Right. She knew exactly what I was going to say.
Right.
You know, they're bragging about Alice in Chains, and they broke them. They turned them down. They said Lane's voice is wrong. That was the first station we went to.
Right. Right.
Who? How this guy going? How Man in a Box is that going? There was a syndicated radio station in Texas. They had like 100 stations across the country, you know?
Yeah.
And they picked it up. And that was it. Jerry, amazing guitar player. You hear we did this? They had this, we did this while we were doing vocals, and they had this staircase in the studio leading up to the roof. So I put Jerry's amp in the staircase, and he stood down below. He had a mic up there. And so I mic'd it two places, one right on him, one up the stairway. And it was just instantly, it sounded right. You just, you know, that's what I like.
So he was soloing next to his amp?
Yeah, he was by his amp, so you get the feedback and all this stuff. But the, you know, it just, sometimes you don't know where you're going to be and when it's going to happen, but it happens if you just stick your heart to it. The Machine.
Voice box?
Yeah, this, you know where this came from? The voice box, I was listening. I was listening to a radio station up in Seattle.
Yeah.
And I was trying to decide on a sound that we could use that would be a catchy sound. So I was listening to a rock station up in Seattle, and it was that song by Jon Jovi.
Right.
Living a Dream.
Yeah.
And I came in, I said, don't kill me. Just let me finish before you kill me. I said, wow, 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 like the Bon Jovi's got. And Jerry goes, yeah. So we went over to Fifth Street Music in Seattle, and I bought a wah-wah. And, you know, we bought a voice box. Wah, 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 wah,
right.
And he had the wah-wah, but that voice box thing. And this was the only sound we ever used the voice box on, and it's still sitting around someplace. And to me, it should be in a museum in Vegas.
Where is it? Who has it?
It's laying around someplace.
Second?
It's laying around someplace.
You have it?
No, I don't have it. He never used a voice box before either. Jerry had never used a voice box. That, like, the first time you hear him using a voice box is that record.
Right. It's amazing. Absolutely amazing.
I do have to say that working with them, it fulfilled a dream of mine to get a guitar sound that I would love,
right.
You know, that I found to be really hard to get, and to be usable in a track with all sustain on it. You can just wipe everything out. But after I got this done, I told my wife, Sharon, at the time, I said, I can die now, go to heaven. I said, I just recorded an album that I love, you know.
So thanks, Dave. That was amazing. Please, of course, leave a bunch of comments and questions below. I think this is one of the most important songs of the 90s and one of the most important songs ever. You rock. Thank you, mate.
Thank you. Warren.